first thing you're going to do is let you know what unit this is. Instead of 2004 Super Duty 5.4 truck, gasoline. The unit's called a 4R100. Early units that are very similar are called E40Ds. They've used this unit from 1989 to about 2008-9. It's a very common unit. It's one of Ford's biggest transmissions, automatic transmissions they built. So let's get started. I got everything already cleaned up. No need to show you how to take it apart. Putting it together, I think, is where most people have problems. If you want to build a good, strong, durable unit, what I recommend the most and what makes my transmission stand out from everybody else's is that I change all the bushings. So what I'm going to do now, before anything else, first thing is to change these bushings. I'll show you how to do that. My tool of choice is this chisel that looks like this. It's actually a muffler chisel for exhaust work. Just wipe off the oil and get your favorite hammer that you're used to. On this unit, three bushings I like to change. They're going to be two sun gear bushings that go in here and here. A case bushing, one piece made by Sonex, and a pump bushing. Earlier pump bushings, don't get confused, they're almost identical, except the early one, the height is about 10 to 20 thousandths wider. Year 2000, they had a narrow bushing, so make sure you match up the bushing that is in your transmission. Bushing drivers, you'll see the step on here. You'll notice that you got it at the right height when the step is flush with the gear itself on both sides. Otherwise, there's a little loophole here and you'll block that off. And after a nice long road test, you'll destroy all the gears in it. So make sure you don't go too far deep. You see how it's flush? That's how you know it's down the right proper way. And then you always look through here. If you can't see light through that hole, it's no good. Good. The next bushing is going to be the case bushing. There are two bushings in here, and we're going to put in a one piece. So first thing, you knock them out. Okay, take out one piece. There's going to be grooves here. There's one with side with three grooves and one with one groove. The three grooves go in the bottom, and then there's a hole here. I'm going to match up this hole with the hole in the case right here. So, eyeball it up. Grooves, three grooves down. And again, it's just eyeballing. You don't want to mess this up because then you're going to ruin your bushing if it goes in wrong. Now for the pump bushing, we got our seal, our bushing. First thing first, knock out your seal. Now, be careful, there's a step here on the front. So make sure you push the bushing out that way or else you'll crack your actual pump, and I would not use it once that's cracked. Best bet is to take again something like this. Get in there. There's a little hole. Put it on that side. That side. Done. Bushing is out. Make sure it's nice and clean. Pushing this lube line here, line that up, mark like that. Again, use the press.
Start with one story.
See that it's now flush with that rim, and the groove is up on that mark right there. Okay. Alright, next step. Let's put our pressure regulator assembly back inside the pump. Use air to clean, never use a rag. The lint from the rag will clog the filter. And most likely hang up valves, and it's never good. Never ever use a rag to clean your parts. Use some sort of solvent with air, compressed air. Okay, so we got our springs in there, a valve. You always want to take this apart. Because if this thing hangs up, the whole unit's coming out. Make sure that fits in here nice. Air it back and forth. Gotta put a little grease in there to hold it in place so I can turn it upside down. Yeah, I'm gonna put some grease. on lower end. This is an aftermarket boost valve. Somebody already built this transmission, and this is what's in here. Now, there's nothing usually wrong with the original one. I very rarely change them unless it's really destroyed. But a lot of guys out there, they like to change them for some reason. They like to spend a lot of money on new parts, but you can save money. You don't need to change this unless it's totally wiped out. Alright. I'll get back to you in a second when I find out. Alright, I'm back. I found the snap ring. And I'm going to put this assembly together. A little glue in there. I could even want to spray a little oil down there. Slide in nice. Remember our little valve glued in there with some grease. We'll use our snap ring plug. This is a trick. In. Now I'm going to open up the rest of the parts and then we'll come back. Okay, you know what? I'm going to show you everything that we bought in this transmission. And I'll open it. Probably spent around $250 to $300 worth of parts to rebuild this the right way. Want to build it, it's going to last a long time. Over here we have a 5-year, 50,000 mile warranty, so it's longer than the factory. We got a brand new solenoid block. Very rarely change them, but the problem with the old one is so corroded inside. Basically, look inside these pins, if they're green and corroded, otherwise, they pretty much last a long time. I've rarely seen problems with them if they're not corroded in there. Here's the forward drum. These are the soft parts. They go on. Alright. These are our inner accumulator springs. Okay, we got our two-wheel drive filter. Our repair kit for the solenoid block inside the vehicle. We'll give that to the installer. And on. Bonded out the piston for our overdrive. These are all our frictions. We're changing every single one. Intermediate spread, again, is something we really don't change, but this one does need it. It's a spiral snap ring for that piston unit, so the OE wheels tend to pop out. So when you get the Sonics, the barrel snap in. Yeah. 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 These are valves. I might not use it. We'll see what happens. These are going to be the outer accumulator springs. And then the overhaul kit itself. Through this stuff. I'm gonna throw this out to make some room here. It's all open up. And in this box, I'm actually gonna save this box because I got a mail it jacket that's sold on eBay just this morning. And this will fit perfectly. So I'll put this in. Hopefully I won't forget that to bring that home tonight. Alright, so we got everything laid out. First step, work from the ground up. You're going to want to go from the bottom up. So we're going to get our reverse piston. Get our lip seals in here. These are late ones, so they're lip seals. The early ones had lathe cut seals. And if you're not sure and you threw out your lip seals already, you can look at the edge of this. If there's a step down, that's a lip. It's flat and the same size, then you're gonna have a lathe cut. Now a lot of these lip seals, if you're not used to it, they will look kind of all the same and very easily mixed up in it. I have done a lot of these, so probably in the thousands, and I can see right away which is what. But when you're getting your lip seals, take your time. Doing this for your own car, your own vehicle, and you want to save some money. Just take the time, you know, even better, you know, match them up, take care of what I used to do when I first started was, I used to take them off individually, the old ones, and then match them with the new ones, and I wouldn't throw them out until I had an exact match, because sometimes the differences in them are so small. And very, very hard to tell which goes where sometimes. Alright, so this will go on the bottom of the unit. Flip this over like this. Now, this is a very big unit. Very clumsy because it's so heavy. So I'm going to use a little of my transmission grease, special transmission grease that dissolves when it gets heated up and it just turns into the transmission fluid. Don't use bearing grease because that will not dissolve. Grease that up, and then I use my fingers also, and I'll feel, make sure that lip seal's in properly. You know, make sure it's not upside down, make sure it's not hanging out a little. And I always use my fingers. Don't use a brush because you won't have the ability to feel it with a brush like you do your fingers. So we push that in there. That usually goes in nice. If you have to force it, something's wrong. Take it back out, re-inspect it, maybe a little more grease. I usually use dowel pins to put the race in. You'll see a hole here. That hole is going to line up the hole in the case. I'll put my dowels on either side of the hole here, this loophole. The dowels you make yourself. I just take some long bolts. I cut them in. I cut the top of the bolt off. Sometimes I'll put a little slit in there so I can fit a screwdriver in it to undo it. But as long as you get something in there, old bolts work perfectly for that. And then you have forever. Hold on. This will help. Okay. Again, match this hole up with a hole down here. gun. Get a screwdriver. And then your bolts. These are very odd looking bolts. You can see. There's only one place these go. It's right down here. So the older units, you didn't have to use a screwdriver, but then with the later, newer design, starting in 96, 97, you have to use a screwdriver to put it in. You just start it with one, take another bolt, go to the other side. Work it through. Dowels out, and it's always nice. I double check, make sure that my hole is right where it's supposed to be in between the dowels, and it is. So take them out, put in the last three bolts. All right, now take it back on the ground. So these later units also, unlike the earlier ones, have a little plastic seal back here. Just pop it out. Put a little air in there. What I'll do is I'll take all the small parts, put them in a little tray, get all organized, and you get your new little seal. This. You just knock it in there. Next, put our parking control in, three pieces, spring. Now we need some bearings. All our bearings, I already cleaned them off earlier. Just use solvent to clean these, never use water. So this goes down like that. And then our output shaft. Alright, now the tricky part. I know what I'm going to do. Is this. We're going to get ourselves ready. We got a little balancing act to go.
Obviously, change of plans on that Cougar one. We're not going to be building that, more than likely.
Yeah,
so
I heard.
If we can get another one of these 475 stocks done today, that would be
okay.
Primo.
Got the parts.
I know. That's what I'm saying. So I will let you be.
All right. All right. Yeah. So now we're going to get... This is my tool. I don't use to hold the unit up while we're building. Okay. Next, low reverse friction. Did a little modification on this one, so I'm gonna get one more friction here that. Like action. What I did is change the pressure plate, and I put a C6 pressure plate in its place, and allows me to use 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It's going to be 7 clutches. This vehicle originally came in, it had 5 frictions, 5 clutches back there. Now we're going to have 7. I'll be right there.
Goes in first. Sometimes it can be a little stubborn. Washer, I glue it on with some grease. Now, if the tranny is going to sit for a while, I definitely recommend using a little tranny oil on the gears so it doesn't develop any rust. First step is you're going to pick that hub, the reverse hub, up as high as you can. So pick it up, you want to spin it. There's a sprag there, so it's only going to spin one way. And then we're going to put this down. We've got the one washer here. Don't worry about the other washer right now. You don't want to, you just want it to kind of drop down. Don't want to bang it down and then use that snap ring. Lock it. Okay. Now I'm just going to check everything. Get a look out. Right in the bottom, there's a hole. You hear how it? Solid. No leaks, no squeaks. So that reverse is okay. Make sure it spins one way, locks the other. We're good. Next, we're going to put the washer on top. The same washer. There's no difference between the top and the bottom washer. They're exactly the same. Put that down. Take our sun gear. Now, a little grease on the new bushings that we put in earlier. It'll help it go down and help it protect it against any wear on the first initial start. That's in. And then we have our front planet, which is this. This one's already been changed with a nice steel one. A lot of times they're aluminum. The gears blow up a lot. The bearings go bad in here. This gets worn, which rides against this hub. So keep your eye out on these things. These things normally go bad.
quite often. So, but this one's okay. We're going to put a nice bearing down there. And then the other bearing is going to sit on the top. But I'm not going to put this on. Yeah, it's going to look like that. At any time, if you have to force something together, you definitely do not have it together right. These things will just fall into place. I mean, it's really pretty simple. With very, very little force. All right, so next we take our ring here. Drop that down. Washer. All right, next we're up for the forward drum. But what I'm gonna do, early direct drums had a washer here. Now, if this was the early one, I would build this first and then Loctite the washer into the drum. So when you turn it upside down, it stays there. However, we're gonna go in order on this one because this is a later one, which does not require a washer there. So you might see in books that the washer goes there and you take apart your unit, you think you might have lost it or, you know, something happened, you order one, don't worry about it. Late ones do not come with it. All right, so next step is building these drums. Put your O-ring in the drum, get your piston. Where is our piston? Piston, come out wherever you are. Does anybody see our piston? Okay. What I do is I shake it, get a little bull rattling, get our lip seal, then on. Feel it, make sure it's alright. So wear out in here, make sure that it's not worn. And back to the grease. It's a tool that I made. It's not a, you know, just find something very thin so you can push the lip seal down as you're going. I made this actually out of a drawer remover tool from Snap-on. The Snap-on toolbox has these pieces here that you can take the drawers out, and then I just put it against a metal pipe and use the press to clamp it shut, and that's it. Get like a brass tube or a steel tube, and I've had this one for many years. It's been working great. And again, these are a little tricky. Don't get discouraged. Can't get it in right away. You will eventually get it in. I promise you. They are tricky. But never force it. Next, we take our little ring, our flower bevel spring, cut that down, and then as I came apart with the unit, I marked each snap because each one of these snap rings are a different size. So this one I know goes on the bottom of the forward drum because I marked it at down the bottom. Steels, snap ring, this one, and our frictions. Pressure plate, wig, steel, all that. Regular steel, friction, steel, friction. right. Ceiling rings. Ooh. The old ones are on. Take the old ones off. Same, by the way, as the other bearing in the front planet. Those two bearings are exactly the same.
Now,
lower it in. You'll feel it, you hear like a clunk when it hits the bottom. Next, we want to put, we have another bearing that sits on top of that. This one. And then just put a little grease. Now for the direct drum. Okay. Alright. We're gonna put the pump together. I'll show you how to do the bushing, put the seal in, put some grease where the spring is, so it doesn't pop out. So in one spot I do like to use Loctite. So you don't need much, it's just a very little bit. Very, very little bit. And then you're gonna want to use your bushing driver. Or you could use the press, but this will go in with the press driver. At it. Take some of that. Once it's in gears, make sure they're clean. Spray a little cleaner on there. Do a blow job. And grease again. You know. Usually the cleaner side's facing up. Make sure our pump is okay. Not a little, actually it's a lot, on the bushing and the inside of the inner gear, so when the installer goes to put it in, it pops right in. Alright, now the other half of the pump. We've got three valves in here. We already did the PR valve, the pressure regulator valve, we had all that apart, we put that all back together, make sure the lockup is good. Gonna line it up, drop it right down. Now, this is my trick. Get your bolts. Just get them started. And there's a bunch of ways to do this. I found this way to be the most efficient. Put bolts in there first. And also, this way you don't have to buy any extra tools. You have what's right in front of you. I don't know anybody else that does it this way. But, maybe there are, I'm not really sure. But I kind of found this on my own. Get your gun, not on the highest, maybe like midway. Take the four extension house bolts. You're going to put two on the top. Now, so I put silicone on this, making it a little difficult. Usually not that difficult. Okay, and then you're going to take two, and I usually use these two locations here. Oh my god, whoever did this, I want to kill him. Please, one thing, no. Don't ever use silicone. It's a pain in the neck. Silicone is absolutely horrible. It gets everywhere. to first. Normally, you don't have to do that, but whoever built this unit last obviously did not know what they were doing. I tried to clean all the silicone off earlier, but apparently I did not get it all off, and we're inside the bolts. Still, silicone remains there, and it'll probably be there for the life of this transmission. Alright, by using these four locations, 1, 2, 3,
where am I?
3, 1, 2 here, and then here and here. By putting the extension head bolts in there, it always perfectly lines this thing up. How? I don't know. It just does. And then you just tighten it. To get this back out, just put your finger there, make sure it feels okay. Nice and flat. Good, good. Take our bolts back out. Then, what I do is I have a converter neck that you could get from a little converter company, have them make you a tool, and this is where I use to check all my pumps. Let's make sure they're in perfectly. But you could just use the converter that you're gonna use, that you're gonna install in here. So get your converter, put it on the converter, make sure everything's nice and smooth. Make sure that you're not forcing anything. Make sure that bushing's in right. Okay, put your O-ring on. Washer, squeeze that down with some glue, and we got our bearing. And that's it. Next, we got our Teflon seals. You want to squeeze them a little, like that. Release. A little grease. And these you got to be careful, because they could go on either way. You gotta watch the angle where that cut is. So you do one at a time. Just look. Do the same thing for the other one. Okay. Get some grease around the edge here, especially around that O-ring. Last, you have your converter Teflon seal, same thing, kind of squeeze it together like that, let it expand back out, get some grease on it, and we're gonna put it on. Alright, so that's it. Okay, so I have my sensor board in there, I have the direct drum, the forward drum, the planets. And then the center support has two bolts, so I'm gonna drop the center support in, line up my two bolts. Now that's where I'm up to with this unit. Next is gonna be the beveled spring for the intermediate piston. So I'm gonna line it up. There are three hooks. Put one hook on the top. It doesn't really matter where it is, but it just looks nice that way. It's the way I always do it. You'll see marks on the old center support, and just lean them right where those old marks are. Next, we're going to take our housing for our pistons. It's going to go in this way, line up this bolt with the bolt hole on the case, and then you just want to make sure this is fitting perfectly through the center support. So if you have to make adjustments, you could just move it by hand, see? But I think I should probably be right on the money with this. Just to move it a little bit. No exact science on this, it's just eyeballing it. And then we're gonna slowly, it's such a tight fit. You know, you just wanna slowly get down there. and then make sure you can see that bolt hole. Might be a little off, but don't worry about that just yet. Now, this is the way I get that piston down, because now you got a big spring down. What I did is I took an old sun shell, and I just bent the tabs out a little bit. Okay, this is an old sun shell from this unit. Then I just made a bar and put two holes on the end that line up directly with two holes on the bell housing here. So I'm going to put my tool down. I'm going to get the snap ring. Now, you're not going to be able to get the snap ring in its groove yet, but you're just going to lie it there. And then, where's my... using a bushing drive just to take up some room, because the bolts I'm going to use are going to be right from the unit itself, and they're a little long. So if I had shorter bolts, I wouldn't need that. So I'm going to put that down, and now just get that piston down. Now all we have to do is screw down these bolts. They make special tools for this. I have seen them. They're probably a couple $100, and it's not worth it. Make it on your own. Do yourself a favor, buy a brand new sun shell for your unit that you're building. It's like $15. And then take your old one, even if it's not terribly beat up, and just bend it out and use it as a tool and charge the customer. Alright, so screw it down until it stops. Don't over tighten it. Break something, just eyeball the bottom where the bolt is. Take your screwdriver. I'm gonna pop that snap ring down. Good. Last thing you want is to have a snap ring blow out on a road test or when it's in the car. Always double check. Now we can take this out. Overdrive section. We completed this earlier. It's all together. Locks the right way. Okay, your clutches are in there, so you're gonna flip it upside down and hold it like this. And we're gonna like grab and do a little work. And we're gonna kind of balance it. And then, oh, boom. That's it. Let gravity take care of that. It could be a little tricky. If you don't get it in your first shot, take it back off. Don't try to do any sneaky repairs. Take it back off, take it all back apart, and back together again. Do yourself a favor. Otherwise, you're probably going to miss the friction, or have the hub's not going to be down all the way, or a washer. Alright, next step. We can put our overdrive sticks in there. The pressure plate on overdrive is last, so we're going to put steel in first. Friction. And this too, normally gasoline, E40Ds or AKA 4100s will have only two clutches for the clutch pack and overdrive. Now you could change your pressure plate and add a third clutch. Third clutches are going to be in your diesel applications and your big blocks. I like having the third clutch pack and overdrive. And it's no more than $7 for a brand new pressure plate that's thinner. You want to get the thin pressure plate. And you just pop it in. Now you got three clutches, three steels in there. Okay, get the snap ring in. Okay.
keep all the openings on the snap rings towards the bottom on the snap rings. This way, when oil is lying down, it could move down the channel down here. And if you look straight down, you'll see there's a channel. I'm not 100% sure if I'm right about that, but that's the way I've been doing it for the last 15 years, and it seems to be working. Again, my theory is that let's get that oil running through there. All right, now we got to put the pump in, so we're going to grease up the outside of where the pump sits. I'm going to grease it really well, because these are tight. These are really tight fitting pumps here. I'm going to get our gasket. It's going to be, you know, overhauled. Up. Here it is. Oh, while we're at it, these are no good. Where's my razor? These are absolutely no good. Throw these in the garbage. Never ever use these. The early units, you have no choice. If you have a pan that has little nipples around each bolt, then you have to use the early style of these, which have bigger holes where the bolts go. But these later units have a flat pan. Never use these. Use the rubber pan gaskets. You're better off actually reusing the old rubber pan gasket that was in there than putting a brand new neoprene gasket in its place. All right, get our gasket down in there, line it up properly. So where we are, put this down here. Now, again, you don't have to do it this way. It's the way I do it. Take out your trusty, handy old dowel pins. It's going to be exactly the same size dowel pins that you had before. Again, it's just a couple of old long bolts cut off the top. You could even put in little slits for a screwdriver. I used two. One, pick two holes on your pump assembly. Next, get your input shaft. These late ones, again, the distinction between a late and early is this little line. Don't want to mix this up. This will identify late and early. This is a late one, and this has to match your overdrive section. So you can retro back and forth, but again, you got to know what you have to change, what you don't change, what washers, bearings. There's so many things you have to be aware of. So never just throw in a part without really, really checking everything. You know, in the beginning, you might want to ask a lot of questions, buy books, read, talk to people that are in the business. Most people will be more than happy to answer your questions because they won't take more than a couple of seconds. Best places to ask are the hard parts people, wherever you buy your hard parts. Call them up. They have a wealth of information that they're usually very happy to share with you. All right. So we got our input shaft in there, dowel pins, gasket, our pumps built, we're ready to drop this thing down. Here we go. So let's line it up. Make sure everything's dead. I'm double checking for the bearings, the washers, the seals. And here we go. Now if I did this right, it should drop right down just like that. And you heard it, boop, fall down. In its place, we'll take our dowels out, which is no longer needed. And our kit will come with new washers for the pump. So we'll dig these out. And then we'll tighten this up, and then we're up to the valve body. That's it. Do next, get the unit on the bench, tighten up your bolts. Tight, two, three. That's for your center support. One, two, three. Next, before we forget, we got our EPC spring and ball. Glue the ball on the top of the spring, put it in its little pocket. Next is our servo. I'm gonna pop it right down in there. Servo does not look like that. It's an older one. I would definitely recommend changing it and getting the upgraded, updated servo, which looks like that. The earlier ones had a snap ring and were almost flat, didn't have that bell to it. And yeah. All right, let's put our check balls in its place. Your overhaul kit will come with an array of check balls. Definitely use new check balls. Do not use the old ones, as they tend to shrink over time. So, there's two different sizes, large and small. Only large go down here, and depending on the year, there's different places they could go. Anything 96 and up is going to look like this. 97 and up, you're going to have two here. Even though you have a third check ball there, not all of them get used. One quick way you can tell is take your plate, and if you take your plate, put it over that hole, and if it looks like this, you don't take a check ball. If it looks like that over here, then it takes a check ball. But generally, it's very rare that you have a check ball there. So you have two here, two there. These are all large. One here, one there. There, one there. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So we look good. Next, we need our gaskets. So, what we're going to do is take our plate. We're going to make sure we get the right gaskets now. We're going to line it up. And this one is wrong. You'll see this hole is blocked because of the gasket. See? So this one we'll throw out. This one, I can see it from here. This looks like the right one, and it is. Down this place, get this gasket, goes on top. Now we have this filter, the lines line up in the grooves there, and then give it just a little spin. We have our solenoid block, grease there. Good. A lot of installers, they'll mess this up and they can bend the spring. Make sure that rooster spring is flat and it's not bent. Alright, next, put this little plate on. Tighten anything until everything's together. My next step is going to be to build the accumulator body. So I'm going to stop it here. Building it, meaning taking everything apart, updating it with the new springs, and putting it back together. So I'm going to stop the recording here while I do that, because you don't need to see all that. It might take a good half hour or so. I decided to show you about the valve body because one thing I need to tell you guys is you got to take the accumulator body out and apart, everything that's over here. A lot of times you'll see like this, the springs are broken, or they have somebody was in here before, they'll put the wrong springs in, or a combination. Like this one has broken springs, and it has a room valve. So what I found in this one, whoever built this last, had a huge modulating line valve. This will make this unit crash on every shift. Harsh engagements. It's no wonder this vehicle is here for a transmission. This could be the whole cause of this guy's problem. Generally, you'll see something this big, not on these type of units. They use these same valves and AX4Ns, and only for a few years. And that's the only time I'll ever use something like this. Now, I replace all these on every single one I do. And there's different sizes. So never use this big size 427. Never use that. And the way you measure it is here. Again, there's a lot of different sizes. Measure it right here. And you'll see it's 426 thousandths of an inch. So it's almost a half an inch. We're not using that. In fact, we'll throw this out. Every single one gets a new one. Let's take our valve body, accumulator body, that I have apart right now. And I'll show you what I'm going to put here. Just blow it up. This is a gasoline application, is a 331 thousandths modulating valve. You can see the difference here. Generally, these units go in diesels or big blocks, and if it's going to be a diesel, any diesel, I would use a 372 thousandths of an inch modulating valve. No smaller, no bigger. Any bigger, you're going to have harsh shifts and harsh engagement, and any smaller, it'll be too soft. Gasolines, like 5.4s, I think they even have them in 4.6s, I'm not quite sure, but they do have 6-cylinder applications of this, an 8-cylinder, and if it is a small block gasoline, definitely go with the 331, that's the smallest modulating valve that they make. Between that and our upgraded springs, which are going to change on every single unit, just because they're not broken. Change them. They come in a pack of three anyway. So there's going to be outer and inner. They're going to go like this. Like that. And let's get to building this. First thing to check is make sure the little tiny valves are nice and free in here. A lot of times I'll take them out, but this unit's clean. Sometimes the springs will get hung up in there, and you just want to straighten things out if that's the case. Everything else looks okay. Straighten that out and just double check. All right, so make sure our accumulators are nice. Start on the right. Put them in its place. Make sure it's free. Again, we got our springs. Put them in. And the plug. And there are three small snap. I guess you'll call them retainers, and then one large retainer, the large ones for the modulating valve. Just slap that in there. Bring it back. The bolt I'm using is actually the bolt that goes right in here. Okay, it's a longer bolt. It's just easier. There's a threaded end. Use that to help guide yourself. The next accumulator. Make sure it just falls into place. Take apart, you definitely need the bolts. Take the clip out, have the bolt in there, and then you smack it out like that. It'll come right out. Alright, last one is the 1-2 shift valve. So, accumulator valve. So, we put our accumulator in, our springs, and our plug. Now, when you take these apart originally from Ford, they came with different springs. The 1-2 and the 2-3 was different than the 3-4. We're using all the same though. Sometimes on diesel applications they had two springs, and then the 3-4 they would leave that alone with only one spring. Some was blue and then one white, some white and blue. We'll be a parts supplier, and all three, you're going to get all three exactly the same. Alright? So we'll just take our bolt, put this back. One thing you did miss, I did put this body on and this body. In between here, there are anywhere from, depending on what year, 2 check balls to 5 check balls to 4 check balls. This is where the small ones come into play. You have 2 large ones here and here, and then you have 3 holes for 3 small ones. Most of them only take 2 small ones, but again, check with your plate. Take your plate. Okay? And line it up. And if your plate has a hole like that, then it's only going to take 4 check balls, 2 small ones. If this looks like that, where it's 2 holes, then it's going to have a check ball. So, but it's very rare that you have 5 check bolts on this top here. So, I always double check everything. Okay. Okay, we're not going to tighten anything until we're all settled up. Still got to put our modulating line valve in. And that's one for gasoline. Small blocks is going to be 331 thousandths. Diesels and big blocks is going to be 373. Don't deviate from those measurements, or else you're just asking for trouble. Blow it off, get our valve. The little tit is going to face you when you go in. So these are a little tricky. Try, that just opens up right in. Try just to drop it in. Don't force it. If you're forcing it, it's not in straight. Okay, you got 331, put the retainer, spring, and then I grease the O-ring. Only aftermarkets have O-rings, so don't worry if you don't have an O-ring. But again, I wouldn't build one of these units without changing this. Even if it looks okay, just change it. These will cause so many problems. And then just easily, you just put that in there, snap ring, boom, and then that body is done. Make sure it's nice and clean. If it's going to sit on the shelf for a while, put some tranny oil in it and we'll just squirt it down. But I don't feel like getting messy, so we're just going to put it right down. It's going right in the vehicle after I finish this. Now we can put all the bolts in its place. There's 3 different sizes. There's the really long ones. Then there's the regular size. And then there's these little Torx that only use to go around the solenoid block. So we're going to start putting them in. You can't mix up the Torx ones. It's a T30 size, and it's only for the solenoid block. And then there's these really small ones, which can be easily misidentified as a regular size. I put one in already. There's one more left. Ah, you'll see. See the difference? It's only like a quarter of an inch difference. These tiny ones, there's only 2. One will go here, and the other one will go right here. Alright, and then we got a long one. And then the rest go, the other ones go where they belong there. And then once you find those 2 small tiny guys, then everything goes together pretty quickly. Enough time. lot of guys forget to tighten these up. I'm warning you now, you'll probably forget. Me, I've never forgotten to tighten this up, ever. But I know so many people that have. Especially as an aluminum valve body, it will bend very easy. If you don't have a torque wrench, just take your speed handle and you're gonna do this and go over every single one. I'm not gonna do it, but go over more like that. The other thing to watch out for when you're putting this body in, make sure that the manual valve is lined up with your manual on. Okay? Let's get our filter on. We're almost done. There's two different types of filters, two-wheel drive and four-wheel drive, which has a neck. Now that's the way they identify it. There are two-wheel drive 4R100s that do take four-wheel drive filters. Basically, the difference is going to be in the pan, and you could go back and forth. If your pan is flat, you're going to take a two-wheel drive filter. If it has a hump right here, it's a four-wheel drive filter. And you're going to say four-wheel drive filter, even though it's a two-wheel drive vehicle. That's just the way it goes. Put our, use our rubber gasket on these. Always use rubber. Always use rubber. That wasn't really that funny. I'm not in a laughing mood or joking mood right now anyway. I normally am not a jokester. So, all right, let's get these bolts down. We're gonna tighten them up and then and then that's it. You're almost done building a 2004 R100 out of a Super Duty Ford pickup with a 5.4 liter engine. Again, these types of transmissions, they've been using these, a variation of it called the E40D since 1989, all the way late into the decade of 2000. So, like 2007 or 8, maybe even later. They eventually went over to another design that came out in 04 called a 5R110W, which replaced these 4R100s. The 5R110W is a lot stronger, a lot heavier. They did have its issues in the beginning. I think actually 2003, midway, is when they came out with the 5R110W. Another name for it is called a torque shift. So if you hear somebody mention it as a torque shift, that is the same thing. Alright. Got all our bolts down. Alright. Find my 10mm. It's got to be somewhere. Tie that down. seals in it. Next, just gonna clean this. So these always get rusty. So take a file. Make sure that groove is nice and clean. You gotta press this thing in. It's definitely something's wrong. You gotta clean more out of it. The way to adjust to these things is in neutral. Put your manual arm in neutral. Make sure the line on the white hash is equal to the line on the black mark. Tighten it up. If they are not lined up like that, you will have codes, you'll have problems, won't shift right. Alright, almost done. We'll take our extension housing. Just look and make sure there's no old gasket there. Now, this is why it's always good to keep old braces. So I got a whole drawer full of old races. There's a little weep hole, put the weep hole facing down. Get a race that fits really good. Put that in there. Oh, and you could also use a little grease, make sure that spring doesn't fall out. Now, there's no need for any other silicones or glues or anything like that. These seals have a very tight fit and it's not gonna leak, so just never leak. There's a little grease in the bushing in there. Gasket. There are two different sizes here as well. The short ones are going to go on the bottom. The long ones go everywhere else on these bolts. Okay, make sure that plastic thing that you put in earlier is there. I've just rebuilt a 4R100. Tight. Short ones. Trump with it.